viewers, welcome to the lecture series of financial accounting. Today we shall take up unit 3, and under unit 3 we are going to discuss about the depreciation and its accounting. This is the introductory lecture on the depreciation. So we will learn about the difference between depreciation, depletion and amortization. These are the related concepts under depreciation. We will have a differentiation between these three concepts and learn where they are being used. Then we will learn about the depreciation on different assets, depreciation policies and provisions and reserves. So these are the fundamental things which we are going to discuss under this chapter. And in next chapter we will discuss about the depreciation methods, that is straight line method and diminishing method. Start with our discussion about the depreciation. First of all, we will appreciate the meaning of depreciation, that what exactly depreciation means. Here this word depreciation, the first thing which comes in our mind is something is being reducing, to diminish, something is being going out or reducing in its value. So let us understand what accounting is giving its definition for the depreciation. Depreciation is being defined as, it is the measure of exhaustion of the effective life of an asset from any cause during given period. Now here what is happening, that there is an asset which has a life. It can be 5 years, 10 years, depending upon the economic life which is being associated with that asset. Now it is being exhausting year after year, and the reason can be anything. Or it is not necessary that it is being exhausted year after year. In a given period of time, it is diminishing. It is going to end. So now there can be any reason. These reasons can be use of the asset. It can be the sudden accident by which the useful life of asset has gone down, or there can be passage of time that gradually it is going to end up. So this is the basic framework of depreciation, where any asset having a useful life is diminishing in its value, is what is called about depreciation. This is what we learn about depreciation, that okay, something is going down in its value. Now the identifiable causes of depreciation can be wear and tear. Wear and tear means the use of the asset, as in when we are using, it's going to lose its value. Exhaustion, that is coming to an end, or something which is being depletion. Obsolescence, that is it is getting outdated because of the change in the technology or other reasons, that is it is going out of the order. Efflux of time. Efflux of time means passing of the time, the asset is losing its value. See, for example, the car. If a car is being purchased and having a certain model number, when the time passes, it's reducing its value. It can be a reduction in the value because of the use, but efflux of time means with the passing of the time or upgradation of the technology, the depreciation is going to take place in the value of the asset. Now we have discussed that there are related terms of depreciation. The first one is depletion. What do you mean by depletion, and how does it differ from the depreciation? Depletion implies removal of an available but irreplaceable resource. Now again here what is happening, that there is removal of certain asset and it is irreplaceable. That means we cannot replace the thing which we have lost. For such resources, we are not going to use the depreciation accounting, but the depletion method of accounting is to be used, such as extracting coal from a coal mine. So the natural resources is being reduced or it is not being replaced. So under this method, it is called depletion. Cost allocation for natural resources is to be done. So applying the method of doing the accounting for depletion, we are going to reduce its value. Now another term is amortization. How does it differ from depreciation? The process of writing off intangible asset is termed as amortization. Now here a distinction is being made over here on the basis of nature of asset. Tangible assets are being categorized as those assets which can be touched and felt, such as plant, machinery, building. Intangible assets are those which cannot be touched or felt, but they are having their economic value. Now here we are going to use the amortization method of reducing the value of these intangible assets, which are patents, copyrights, leaseholds, or any other intangible asset which is being categorized as intangible asset on the basis of its nature, such as goodwill. So here we are going to write off its value on the basis of period of asset which is being used. It can be economic life of that asset, or the period for which the asset is being used, that is called its economic life. So we will write off each year certain amount to reduce that asset or to write off those assets, and these assets would be definitely going to be the intangible assets only. So here very clear demarcation is being made that where tangible assets are there, we are going to use the depreciation method of accounting. Where intangible assets are there, we are going to use the amortization method of accounting. And where the resources are such which are not being replaced, or they are natural resources such as extraction of coal from the coal mines, we are going to use the depletion method of accounting. Now we will do a short exercise to ascertain that whether we have understood these concepts relating to amortization, depletion and depreciation in relation to the asset which is being going to depreciate. So first of all, coals and minerals, they are natural resources which cannot be replaced, so we will use the method called depletion. Goodwill. Goodwill is an intangible asset, so the method used will be amortization. Plant and machinery, they are tangible assets and it is being depreciated using the method called depreciation. Patents, amortization, since they are intangible assets. Oil fields, again the depletion will be used. So I hope now the concepts relating to depreciation, depletion and amortization is very clear. Now moving ahead, we will learn what do you mean by depreciation accounting. So here now accounting aspect is being dealt in relation to depreciation. Depreciation accounting is a system of accounting which aims to distribute the cost or other basic values of the tangible capital asset less salvage, if any, over the estimated useful life of the unit in a systematic and rational manner. Now understanding the small chunks of this definition, we can ascertain what do we mean by depreciation accounting. Again, it's a system of accounting which aims to distribute the cost or other basic values of the tangible capital asset. So here the asset which is being dealt with is the capital asset, and its cost plus other basic values. They can be the cost associated with acquisition of those assets, adding them up. Now what we are going to subtract is the salvage value. Salvage value means the value which asset is going to fetch from the market at its end value. When the useful life of asset comes to an end, and if you go to the market and sell that asset, what you are extracting out of that sale is called the salvage value. With that salvage value, we will reduce the cost, and then we will use the useful life of the asset as the base to ascertain the amount of depreciation. This is the basic fundamental concept in relation to depreciation accounting. Now we will learn about the depreciation of different assets. These different assets can be goodwill, which is called our intangible asset, freehold land. Then we have to analyze whether there will be any depreciation policy on freehold land or not. Freehold building plant, etc., leasehold land and building, how they are going to be depreciated. Loose tools, jigs, livestock, patents, trademark, freehold building plant, mine oils, quarries. We have already learned in a small chunk that what accounting method or depreciation method we are going to use in relation to certain set of assets. This method we will use that how we are going to depreciate these assets. Firstly, goodwill. It will be depreciated over a period of 5 years as per the accounting standards, which prescribes that goodwill needs to be written off under a period of 5 years. Secondly, freehold land, it need not to be depreciated because the value of land is going to appreciate over the period. So by no means freehold land is going to be depreciated in our books of accounts. freehold building plant at fixed installment or diminishing balancing method. These are the two methods of doing the accounting of the asset, that is how we are going to depreciate it, either fixed installment method or the diminishing value method. Their other names are WDV method and cost methods. So when we will learn the accounting in detail about the depreciation, we will discuss about these two methods. So generally for freehold building plant machinery, we are going to use either of these two methods to record the transactions in relation to depreciation in our books of accounts. Leasehold land and building, again we are going to use only fixed installment method for this. Loose tools, jigs, livestock, here we are going to use the revaluation method of depreciation. Patents, trademarks, fixed installment method, in a way that they are written off with the legal or commercial life of asset. And in another words, we can say that amortization is to be done for these assets. Mine, oil wells, quarries, depletion method, which we have already discussed. So overall, we have categorized the assets for which the particular method of accounting of depreciation is to be followed. Now let us understand another aspect in relation to depreciation, and it is called depreciation policy. Under depreciation policy, first important parameter which we have to analyze is the selection of appropriate method. As we have already discussed that depending upon the nature of the asset and the use of the asset, depreciation method has to be adopted. Now once it is being adopted, it needs to be disclosed in the books of accounts in the proper notes to the financial statements that we have applied either diminishing method or straight line method or replacement method. Whatever method has been used, firstly we have to select it, then we have to disclose it, and we have to apply it consistently on the basis of the accounting policies and principles of the business entity. Second is periodic review of provision. We have already discussed that there should be a selection of method. Once the method is being selected and disclosed, year after year it need not to be changed, but the management has to ensure that they have reviewed the provisions which is being reflected in the books of accounts. So any change in the economic scenario or the legal position or accounting standards required any change in the method of accounting, this needs to be done in the books of accounts, and for that very purpose the periodic review of provision is being necessary. So second step under depreciation policy is the review of the provision, which is to be done on a periodic basis. It doesn't suggest that there should be a change, but it suggests that it needs to be reviewed, and if any change is being required, the same has to be done on the basis of the guidelines which are being given for the depreciation policies by Institute of Chartered Accountant of India and the accounting standards. Lastly, evaluation and disclosure of depreciation policies. We have to evaluate our depreciation policies that we are following the depreciation method using the rates which are being prescribed by the Income Tax Act or which are being applicable to the business entity as per Companies Act in the given schedules of the Companies Act. Then we have to disclose these policies that we have applied such policy and we are consistently applying it. Disclosure of the accounting policy is a necessary step under the accounting standards which needs to be ensured by the business entity that they have complied with the disclosure and evaluation requirement of their depreciation policy. Now next important thing is provisions and reserves. Let us understand what do we mean by it and how do they differ from each other. As per part 3rd of schedule 6 of Companies Act 1956, provision shall means an amount written off or retained by way of providing depreciation, renewals or diminution in the value of asset, or retained by way of providing for known liability of which the amount cannot be determined with substantial accuracy. So let us understand what do we mean by the detail regarding the provisions which is being given under the part 3rd of schedule 6th of Companies Act. So under Part 3 of Schedule 6 of Companies Act, it is very clearly being given what do we mean by provision. They said that where you cannot exactly determine the amount of any known liability, you have to make the provision with substantial accuracy. So what happens that our liability is known, but we are not sure about the amount, that how much exact amount we need to pay against that liability. So with a substantial accuracy or a certain mathematical formula, we are going to ascertain that amount. Say for example, we have to make a provision for doubtful debts. So analyzing the past trends, we have observed that only 5% of debtors are going to be bad debts. So we will make a provision of 5% on the debtors. Now it is a known liability that almost around 5% of the debtors would not pay. The liability is known, but what amount it is going to be there, it is not known to us. So we will make a provision with a substantial accuracy. A percentage would be determined, and on the basis of that percentage, we will retain certain amount or the value of the asset by way of providing depreciation. So this is the meaning of provision. Now what is reserve? Very simple definition of reserve is that whatever excess provision has been made is termed as reserves. Reserve shall not include any amount written off or retained by way of providing depreciation, renewal or diminution in the value of asset, or retained by way of providing for any known liability. If the amount of provision is in excess of the amount which is in opinion of the directors is reasonably necessary for the purpose, the excess shall be treated as reserve and not a provision. For example, we have made a provision for any asset, and if it is more than the required limit, whatever more provision we have made, it is to be considered as our reserves and not the provision against that known liability. So here is our table showing the distinction between reserves and provisions. Let us analyze it. Reserve, it is an appropriation and does not affect the amount of net profit because we are appropriating from the P&L appropriation. However, provision is a charge against profit and loss account and reduce the amount of net profit. When we make a provision, we are going to make it from the P&L account. So our profits are going to reduce by the amount of provision we have made. However, the reserves are not going to affect the net profit. Coming to the reserves, it is created only when the profit is earned. If there are adequate profits, only then we are going to make reserves. And provision, it is created and charged to the profit and loss even if there is a loss. So it has nothing to do with the profits being available, it is a charge. So obviously whether there is profit or not, we have to make the provision. It is being based on the principle of prudence, that we have to make the provision for the expected loss, while the anticipated incomes are not being provisioned for, however loss is to be provisioned. Again, coming to the reserves, it is created to strengthen financial position and to meet the unforeseen losses. Those losses which can be there, predictable losses, against that we have created a reserve out of our profits. While provision is created to meet known liability of which the amount cannot be determined with substantial accuracy. Reserve, it is a part of owner's fund and recorded along with capital on the liability side of balance sheet. So firstly, capitals would be there, and under our reserves or owner's fund, we are going to use the reserves. So reserves are part of owner's fund. However, provisions, when we discuss, it is generally created to provide for likely decrease in the value of asset and is shown as deduction from the asset concerned. So for example, let us take an asset called plant and machinery. Now what happens that we have made a provision for depreciation against plant and machinery. So rather than showing provision on the liability side, what we will do that if the plant and machinery is of 1 lakh rupees, we will subtract the provision if it is being made, say for example 10,000. So 1 lakh plant and machinery less provision for depreciation 10,000, so 90,000 would be reflected as our WDV or the diminishing value of asset. Similarly, such provisions can be made for debtors, and the debtors subtracted provision for doubtful debts, then the net amount of debtors would be reflected on the asset side of our balance sheet. and reserves, we have already discussed that they shall form part of owner's capital and would be reflected on the liability side. Now students, we are going to summarize our lecture of today based on depreciation. Under today's lecture, we have learned the meaning of depreciation, that it is a diminution in the value of the asset on the basis of its use or wear and tear or obsolescence or efflux of time for a given period, and it is also different from depletion and amortization. We are using the different methods of diminishing the value of asset on the basis of the nature of asset, such as for intangible assets we are using the amortization method of accounting, where we are writing off the depreciation over a period of years and generally it is economic life of the asset. Then depletion is being used where the asset is of such nature which is related to the irreplaceable resources such as coal mines, oil fields. Then coming to the last category, that is tangible assets such as plant and machinery, we are going to use the method called depreciation to diminish the value of assets, and these methods can be WDV method or straight line method or any other method being suggested and adapted by the management on a consistent manner. We have also learned about the depreciation policies, that for the management it is necessary to select the appropriate policy, then evaluate such provision which is being made on a periodical basis. Then we have to disclose the accounting policies, as it is the mandatory requirement of accounting standards to disclose the accounting policy and to evaluate it from time to time. We have also learned the important differentiation between the provisions and reserves, why provision is being created and what is the use of reserve. Provision is being created for a known liability where the amount to be spent is not known and a suitable accuracy is being taken up for making such provision, and whatever excess provision is there, it is being considered as reserve. Reserves are being made out of profits and provisions are charged over the profits. We have taken up an example already to make a distinction between the two important concepts. With this, we are ending up our lecture of today. Hopefully, all the concepts relating to depreciation has been understood. We are ending up our session of today. Thank you.